what's that? I'm not going right now, so what but anyway, that's kind of a long session low key, it seems like. Let's go though. The Wendy Williams Experience. Inner City Broadcasting had been founded on one. Inner City Broadcasting had been founded in 1970 as one of the first African American owned radio networks. The station's primary owners were famed Harlem Power broker Percy Sutton and Clarence Jones, who had published the Amsterdam News. Notable stakeholders included future New York City Mayor David Dinkins, Malcolm X's widow, Betty Shabazz, and Roberta Flack. And the battery's running low, so that's good. I want to call my mom just real quick. You know, so. Inner City made a splash in New York City with WBLS, I don't know what it is, WBLS, an R&B station led by Frankie Crocker. One of the iconic DJs, Dr. Evans, had me study. During the late 70s and early 80s, the station became the number one black station in New York. Crocker was a true innovator, refusing to get boxed into the traditional limitations of black radio. He played records by rock acts like The Clash and Blondie, alongside new records from soul groups MSFB or Harold Melvin. Giving zero fucks about what a black station was supposed to sound like. If a record had sold, he played it. And that really resonated with me because these were the same acts that my father used to play at Zebra Club back in Monk's Corner. Higher, baby. Like I said, if some British white boys like Queen had a funky song, the club was going to play it right alongside James Brown and George Clinton. You feel me? Good music doesn't have a race. Unfortunately, Crocker got caught up in a payola scandal and was forced off the station, leaving black radio a lot less interesting. But WBLS continued to dominate, and thanks to a new wave of hip-hop DJs like the legendary Mr. Magic and Molly Mall. Alright? I saw a remix from him the other day. By the mid-2000s, one of the biggest personalities on WBLS, alongside Steve Harvey was Wendy Williams. Wendy had risen to stardom at New York's Hot 97 before she was fired, according to the rumors, for either insinuating that Diddy was gay, or getting in a physical fight with fellow jock Angie Martinez, Starbuck, or maybe the combination of both. Regardless, after a successful stint at Power 99 in Philadelphia, that's crazy, showed Wendy made her triumphant return to NYC in 2001. After WBLS hired her to host afternoon drives. If you're interested in hearing more about her story, I recommend her autobiography, Wendy's Got the Heat. Since Inner City owned Hot 103.9, Power Hot, I love the Hots and Powers, but the company decided to syndicate her show in the afternoon in Columbia. It was a decision that didn't sit well with a lot of people locally. Our PD, Chris Connors, had been hosting a popular afternoon show that included the very popular 5 o'clock Mega Mix. It felt like the suits in New York were shitting on us when we ended up getting bounced for Wendy. Wendy was a big star nationally, but the listeners in Columbia raised hell and kept calling in and writing letters demanding Hot bring Chris's show back. Finally, Inner City gave in and put Chris back in his old slot, provided Hot would run Wendy's show at night from 10 to 2. That compromise unwittingly changed the course of my life. I gotta go. So, that right there, let me see if you got a sweet nap. Constantly in my life. Gotta go though, man. You know how we do. Could've.